Hey guys, before we get started, I would like to give a trigger warning that there is talk of suicide, a death of a child, sexual assault, and just a really gruesome crime scene that involves bondage too. So just, if you're not okay with hearing any of that and it makes you upset, please just choose a different video and don't feel that you need to continue to watch this one to get your true crime fix. Hey guys, it's April. And we are here with another Crimetober video. Today we are going to be talking about the horrible case of Max Shaknai and Rebecca Zahau. Rebecca was a 32-year-old Burmese immigrant. She had moved to the U.S. about 10 years before this happened, and she was the middle of three sisters. In 2008, she had married a nursing student named Neil Nalepa. But during this marriage, she had met a Jonah Shaknai and had started an affair with him. Shaknai was a rich man. He was the CEO of a pharmaceutical company that she met at a job in Arizona. In February 2011, Nalepa and Zahau did divorce, and that is when her and Shaknai became public. And people said they were very much in love and just so happy all the time. They seemed like the perfect couple. Jonah was a self-made billionaire who was 54 at the time. He was the ninth highest paid CEO in Arizona, earning around $64 million in 2010. He mostly sold Restylane, which was a cosmetic filler. He mostly lived in Arizona, but he did own a second home in Coronado, California, known as the Speckles Mansion. His first wife was a woman named Kimberly James. He had two children with her and had to fight for custody for 3 years after the divorce. His second wife was named Dina Romano, and they had their third child, which is the child we will be talking about today. And his name was Maxfield Aaron Shaknai. But him and Dina did divorce in 2008. Max was known as the happiest six-year-old boy. He was very developed for his age, but he was not a daredevil. Now let's talk about the Speckles Mansion. This is one of the most beautiful homes I have ever seen. It's right on the ocean, and it has 10 bedrooms and 11 bathrooms in it. So Rebecca was staying at the Speckles Mansion during the summer of 2011. She stayed there with Max while Jonah was working, and for a little bit of the time she had also had her sister Zena there. So one day while Zena and Rebecca were watching Max, they heard a really loud noise. They ran to look to see what it was, and Max had fallen from the second story banister to the first story floor. She told Zena to call 911 right away. So like I said, Max had fallen from the second floor banister. He had been playing with a scooter, and it was found resting on his leg, and the chandelier that hung from the ceiling had fallen, but it wasn't on top of Max. It was around him. There was also several soccer balls nearby. He had fractured facial bones and a spinal injury. And the spinal injury was known to have paralyzed him almost instantly and would have made him lose his speech. Nobody witnessed the fall though. Rebecca was in the bathroom and Zena was getting ready for a shower. So it was very unclear how Max fell off this banister. Rebecca had told paramedics that she had heard him say Ocean, which Ocean is the name of their household dog. First responders did hear Rebecca say that Dina was going to kill her. Max was taken to a children's hospital and was immediately put in ICU, and Dina and Jonah were by his side every day. Max was unresponsive and he wasn't breathing on his own, which did spike concern that he was never conscious. So how was he saying Ocean? Now, there was two main theories at this point in time. Either he had gone over the banister while he was was playing with his scooter, or someone could have pushed him off. Police did end up concluding that this was just a terrible accident. So what could have happened to Max? Because this is nuts, right? Max loved to play in that hallway where the staircase was. He could have been riding his scooter and just had fallen. It was thought that maybe Ocean had tripped him accidentally, which caused him to fall over the railing, and that he tried to grab the chandelier on his way down, which was what caused the chandelier to fall. But some people just believed there was no way this was an accident. Dina ended up hiring a private firm to look into this, and they did conclude some strange things. They concluded that Max's center of gravity was too low for him to ever fall over the railing naturally, especially with his scooter. And the shag carpet would have caused him to not be able to get the speed it would take him to go over that banister. Plus, Max had no cuts on his hands at all. So how would he grab a glass chandelier and not have anything happen to his hands? And there was just no way any expert could replicate what happened. But something interesting they did find was there was white paint on the bottom of his scooter, which perfectly matched to the banister. So maybe he was trying to ride his scooter down the railing, but that doesn't make sense either because he wasn't known to be a daredevil. So the next day after the fall on July 12th, Rebecca took Zena to the airport to send her home. He also picked up Jonah's brother Adam from an airport that day too. Adam was from Memphis and he had been a boat captain since the 90s. He was planning to stay in the guest house to just be there for Jonah and make sure everything was going okay. Rebecca also picked up Dina's twin sister Nina, and Nina said Rebecca was acting really strange. She would not directly tell her at all what happened to Max. Rebecca, Jonah, and Adam did go out to dinner this evening. Jonah had went back to the hospital to stay with Max because he was still on life support in the ICU. But conditions did seem to be improving. Rebecca and Adam went back to the mansion. Adam claimed he took an Ambien and fell asleep at 8 p.m. But around 9:50 p.m., Rebecca was texting her older sister, Mary, and ended the conversation around that time. And Rebecca seemed perfectly fine during this. An hour later, Nina texted her and said she was going to stop by and she was going to tell her exactly what happened to Max. But Rebecca never answered her. And around 2 hours later, she listened to a voicemail and deleted it. This voicemail was from Jonah saying that Max's situation was taking a turn for the worst. And that was the last bit of communication that was on Rebecca's phone. On July 13th, 2011, at 6:45 a.m., Adam said that he was headed to the main mansion to get a cup of coffee, and that is where he found Rebecca.
Hello, emergency. What are you reporting?
Yeah, I got a girl hung herself in the guest house of it's on Ocean Boulevard across from the hotel, same place that you came and got the kid yesterday.
She was hanging naked from a balcony from a rope around her neck, and her hands and feet were bound with nautical knots along with her neck. The cleat hitch knot that was on her has thought to be a more complicated knot to learn, and not many people would just know how to do this. But the slip knot that was on her was thought to be one of the easier ones. But both are used in boating. And who, did I say, had been a boat captain since the 90s? And plus, her hands were bound behind her back. Her mouth was gagged by a long sleeve shirt. The body of the t-shirt had been wrapped around her neck 3 times, and the sleeves were double knotted and shoved in her mouth. The body was hanging by a reddish orange rope tied around her neck. And it was the same type of rope that bound her hands and feet. And the other end of it was tied to her bedpost. There was also black paint found on Rebecca's fingers and kind of splattered a little bit on her body. Adam said he ran to the kitchen and grabbed a knife and a three-legged table and brought it to where Rebecca was. And he stood on the table so he could cut her down. He removed the shirt from her neck and began CPR. And at 6:48 a.m., during him running into the kitchen and everything, he did call 911. He explained to them that he found a girl that hung herself. He explained cutting her down and trying to do CPR. But the 911 call itself was super weird. He didn't refer to Rebecca by her name once, but he just kept saying the girl who hung herself, like he had never met her. At this time, there was no physical evidence of foul play, but when news outlets heard this, they sent helicopters to the mansion and they captured Rebecca's dead naked body and showed it on TV. And of course, they blurred out her private parts, but are you kidding me? How extremely disrespectful can you be to her family? Another thing that was really strange was they never covered her body once in this investigation. They just left her nude in the grass, which can you imagine the type of elements that harmed that body while it just sat in the grass? The medical examiner didn't get there for 12 hours and she was left like that the whole time, completely uncovered. And that was the first sign that this was going to be a compromised investigation. The balcony in which she was hung from was very dirty, so you were able to see Rebecca's footprints on it, but there was also a partial boot print, but the police just claimed it was a police boot and never examined it at all. And a witness came forward that was their neighbor, saying that they heard screaming that night. And it sounded like a woman and it sounded like she was yelling for help. The police told her she was wrong and was hearing it from a different direction and just brushed her off. But they never interviewed that woman again. And on July 16th, 2011, Max ended up passing away. Rest in peace, Max. You didn't deserve such a short life. So police took all the electronics from this home, but they found a few weird things on Adam's phone. So July 12th throughout the night of July 13th, Adam searched sexy Asian girls and bondage anime, which you can be into whatever you want to be into. Good for you, man. But that's a little weird to be searching bondage anime and then there was a girl bound and killed at this mansion that same night. But the police just claimed it wasn't him that searched it on his phone while he was staying alone in the guest house. Makes sense. Why were the police so in this case? There were two autopsies done and they did vary quite a bit. So we'll go ahead and talk about the first autopsy. It did look like her head had been hit, but they kind of just chalked it up that she hit her head when she jumped off the balcony committing suicide. But it's nearly impossible to hit your head if she jumped herself. Plus, there was not much around the balcony to hit, except for like tree branches. But they weren't like the thick tree branches, so I'm not sure how it would cause significant blunt force trauma to her head. But that's what they said. They also said that there was injury to her neck. Her left arm was fractured. There was multiple scattered bruising and abrasions around her body, especially her back, arms, and legs. And the toxicology report said there was no drugs or alcohol in her system. And the estimated time of death was around 3 a.m. on July 13th, 2011. On September 2nd, 2011, Rebecca's death was ruled a suicide after the autopsy report was released. On the 20th, Jonah wrote a letter to the then Attorney General Kamala Harris. He practically begged for this case to be reviewed, but she did decline. And September 30th, 2011, the family went on NBC and called for an independent investigation. So let's talk a little bit about the evidence in the guest house that absolutely nothing was done about. Investigators found a bottle of clear liquid in there, but they just assumed it was water. It was in the master bedroom where Adam was sleeping, and the bottle was just never tested for DNA. And now for you guys, that might not seem like a big deal, but if there was DNA other than Adam's on that bottle, they could have proven that someone else was there that could have caused this. Or if it was Rebecca's DNA, it could be proven that her and him hung out that night when he claimed he was sleeping at 8 p.m. but was on his phone looking at anime porn. Evidence technicians also found a pair of women's underwear in the trash can at the guest house, but that was never tested for DNA either. Great police work in this case. Now, Rebecca's bedroom was where this supposedly occurred. The rope was tied in a slip knot to her bedpost, not her bedpost. It was tied to the leg of the bed. But the bed was barely moved from the wall. But if Rebecca had jumped from that balcony herself, it would have shifted the bed several feet. There was also a plastic bag found near the bed, and underneath was a tube of black paint. There was also a small enlarged paintbrush and a small enlarged kitchen knife. And the creepiest of all was there was a message painted on her door that said, "She saved him, can you save her?" And police never really figured out what was going on with this piece of information. But no DNA was found in her room but hers. Rebecca's family did end up contacting a high-profile Seattle attorney named Anne Bremner. Once she looked into it, she also believed that suicide could not have been the answer here. And one thing she said was, most women don't tie the rope around their neck and hair, which was how Rebecca's was. So she found it really weird that she wouldn't do that. Anne also noted that most women do not commit suicide naked. So she immediately decided she would take this case pro bono. She had some high connections, so she had some more experts look into this case. The first one she brought in was a Dr. Wedge, who was a forensic pathologist, and he performed the second autopsy. And then she also brought in a Dr. Goodman, who was a forensic analyst. Now, the second autopsy, there was just a lot of damage to her neck. She had severely torn muscles in the front of her neck and the side. It was consistent with hanging, but it was not consistent with only hanging. It could have also been strangulation. The four head wounds suggested she could not have went down vertically, which would have been what she would have done if she jumped herself. The second autopsy suggested it was intentional blows to the head. This autopsy also found that Rebecca was unfortunately sexually assaulted during this. There was blood found in Rebecca's vagina, but it was consistent with period blood. And if you don't know what lividity is, I do have a video on it, so I will put it somewhere on the screen. If she died from hanging, the lividity would have set in her lower limbs. It would not have set in her back. So that was really strange too. Now, Dr. Goodman looked into the images provided from the scene, and he especially looked into that footprint. And that boot print did not match the police boots that were being worn. But he quickly got forced off the case once he found this out and never really explained why. So in February 2018, there was a civil trial. They held a civil trial because they could not get a criminal trial established where the police would not change her cause of death from suicide. But the family did not believe Rebecca killed herself. First of all, they did not think she knew how to tie those boat knots. Or could she have tied her hands the way they were positioned? They claimed this was murder and claimed that she was beaten, gagged, and strangled. They also said Rebecca was not depressed or suicidal, and they pursued this case against Adam, Nina, and Dina. Dina and Nina's alibis checked out almost instantly and were taken off the suspect list, which then left Adam alone. But there were quite a few people that testified in this. Forensic analyst Lisa DeMayo reviewed the DNA reports on the two knives. She did testify that Adam's DNA was not found on these knives at all or in Rebecca's bedroom. And there was absolutely no DNA found on the paintbrushes. But she said that was thought to be wiped down because the paint was clearly from a paintbrush. Only Rebecca's fingerprints were found on the large knife, but they were found on the blade only. And it seemed like she was holding it in a way behind her back to try to cut the rope. But there was no fingerprints found on the handle, but the smaller knife. Rebecca's blood was found on it. The entire bottom of the knife was caked in the grooves. But the type of blood that was found on this knife was period blood, which means Rebecca would have been sexually assaulted with this knife. But nothing was ever done with this piece of evidence at all. And there was no fingerprints found on this knife. There was also a handwriting expert that testified named Michael Waxhill. He compared the painted message on the door against known samples of Rebecca and Adam's writing. He did believe the handwriting was closer to Adam's than Rebecca's. The handwriting was slanted the same way of Adam's, and it had the same characteristics, especially like the way the A's were written. It also matched the height of Adam and not Rebecca. Adam did testify, and he was just very nonchalant and not remorseful at all. And Adam was found liable for Rebecca's death. The original settlement was $5 million in damages, but they settled outside of court for $600,000. And Adam did a very angry interview on his way out of the courthouse. And he called the family posers, whatever that's supposed to mean. The case was ultimately dismissed, but the verdict was noted to remain against Adam. Keith Greer has probably the theory I mostly believe in what happened, so I'm going to share that with you. Rebecca was in the shower and had turned it off. She got out of the shower and Adam confronted her. Something happened which caused her to go to the other side of the house, and you can tell this by the drops of blood and a towel that she dropped in her cell phone being found on the floor. She was struck on the back of the head 4 times by Adam with some object, we don't really know, which knocked her unconscious, which gave him time to bound and gag her, sexually assault her, strangle her, and hang her. And he ultimately believes that this is rage over what happened to Max. San Diego Sheriff's Office did reopen this case at one point in time, but ultimately ruled it a suicide once again. Jonah has supported reopening this case, saying his family deserves closure, but he also paid for all of Adam's legal representation, so that has been a little bit of a mixed signal. But ultimately, I think we have to figure out what happened to Max to ever know what truly happened to Rebecca. Unfortunately, their deaths go hand in hand, and I do not buy that she was just so badly grieving over Max's situation. And I don't think she would have left Jonah grieving this all on his own or give him more to grieve. And all the interviews and things I've watched of Adam just give me the creeps. Like, even if I didn't know him from this case, that man would creep me out. I do think that possibly it wasn't premeditated, but then again, it could. I mean, why would he have all that rope and stuff? But I could see it just being rage over finding out that Max had gotten worse. But ultimately, I don't think anything happened to Max viciously. And to be quite honest, I have no idea what happened to Max. I cannot settle on a theory on that one. That one is so sad, and I can't imagine ever losing a kid that way. And that is the incidents that involve Max Shacknight and Rebecca Zahow. What do you guys think that happened? This one just leaves me so puzzled. Do you guys remember this being on the news? Because I vividly remember those helicopters showing her body on the screen. How disrespectful. Leave your comments below on what you think happened to Max and what you think happened to Rebecca. Do you think it was just a suicide over what happened? Or do you really think that Adam had something to do with it? And I'm still really weirded out that Nina was going to come over. Maybe she just cooled down though. She had an alibi. And ultimately, do you think Jonah knows what happened? Do you think that if Adam did it, he told him? Or do you think that he would have left him in the dark to keep him almost safe from all this? But thank you guys so much for watching. Please like and subscribe for me and hit that notification button. That way you're notified the next time I upload. And if you haven't, go back and rewatch my Unsolved in West Virginia series, because I worked really hard on it and I love it so much. Comment below any cases you would like to see me cover. We have Valencrime coming up. So I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye.